through the discovery of usefulness of silk, so China, so you can see that in the left side, it is the flag of China. So China is credited for the discovery of silk. So having heard the immense value and beauty of this silk, two monks were sent as spies to China and the cocoons were taken to Europe. And the silkworm has since spread all over the world. So China is one of the first largest producer of this silk, and also they are the chief supplier of silk to the world markets. And India, it is the unique distinction of producing all the four commercial varieties of natural silk like mulberry, tazar, eri and muga. Actually, India is the second largest producer of silk in the world next to China, with 14.57% share in global raw silk production. And also in India, the major mulberry silk producing states are Karnataka, Andhra Pradesh, West Bengal, Tamil Nadu and Kashmir, which together accounts for 92% of country's total mulberry raw silk production. So here you can see the graph. It depicts the production of silk from 2014 to 2018-19 year. So here you can see the total, the mulberry accounts for 71.50% with 25,213 metric tons, whereas the tazar it with 8.44% with 2,977 metric ton, and the eri with 19.40% with 6,839 metric ton, and muga it accounts for 0.66% with 232 million tons. So of the professional total raw silk production of 35,261 metric ton. So from the graph, it is clear that the total raw silk production increased by 10.52% during 2018-19 over the previous year. So there are major types of silks of commercial importance. They are classified as pure silk or mulberry silk and non-mulberry silk. Or other varieties of silk. So example of pure silk is mulberry silkworm, that is Bombyx mori, whereas non-mulberry silkworm, it is tazar silkworm, oak tazar silkworm, muga silkworm and eri silkworm. So first let's see about mulberry silkworm, that is Bombyx mori. It belongs to the family Bombycidae and it is totally domesticated insect and it is never found in a wild state. And also it is one of the most important of all the silkworms. And also it is extensively rare in many countries than India. And in India especially, it is cultivated on mulberry in Assam, Bihar, Jammu and Kashmir, Punjab, West Bengal, Orissa, Madhya Pradesh, Maharashtra, Karnataka and Tamil Nadu. So now let's see about the biology of this mulberry silkworm. So here you can see the adult, this is the adult silkworm. It is creamish in color and it lives for only 2 or 3 days only, because soon after mating, soon after the emergence, the mating takes place and each female moth lays about 300 to 400 brownish white seed-like egg in masses. You can see over here. And also the hatching takes place in 8 to 12 days. So, and here the caterpillar on hatching, they will be dark in color. And also there will be 4 molds. The fully grown caterpillar will be yellowish white in color. And also they will be having a small anal horn. So the larval period extends for about 28 to 30 days. And this particular caterpillar, it produces a long continuous strand of silk to form an oval cocoon, and these larvae are the one that are the producer of the silk. And it takes about 1 or 2 days for constructing the same. Next is the pupa. The pupation takes place inside the cocoon, and the adult emerges in 10 to 12 days, and also the whole life cycle, it will complete in 6 to 8 weeks. So next, we will see about the classification of mulberry silkworm races. So they are classified based on volatilism, geographical distribution, number of larval molds, and genetic nature. So first, let's see volatilism. So volatilism is nothing but it refers to the number of broods or generation that are raised per year. It is actually a genetically determined character, and based on this volatilism, it is categorized into three types. One is univolatine, second is bivolatine, and multivolatine. Univolatine means there will be only one generation per year, while bi means, as the name suggests, there will be two generation per year, whereas multi, there will be more than two generation per year. So next is the number of larval molds. There will be tri, tetra, and penta, like 3, 4, and 5 mold. Then based on geographical distribution, that is where they are distributed geographically, it is divided into 4, that is Chinese, Japanese, European, and Indian races. And based on the number of genetic nature, it will be like pure races or hybrid. So next, let's see about some of the characters of some races, like multivolatile races. As I said, the multivolatile mean there will be more than three generations per year. And also the larvae that comes under this race will be resistant to high temperature and also high humidity. And but the cocoons will be of very poor quality. And also the adults will lay non-diaphosic eggs. So some of the example they have given, that is sea nichi. It is actually imported to Mysore from Japan. Next is Nistari. It is introduced from China, and it is now especially seen in West Bengal area. The next race is pure Mysore. It is also imported from China. Sarupat. This race belongs to the northeastern part of India. Next is Tamil Nadu White. These are some multivolatile races that are able to produce the white cocoons. So the sericulture department, they are in Tamil Nadu, they isolated the race called TNW in 1975. And some of the other races that belong to this category is Polar Gold, Kollegal Javan, then Mysore Princess, Hosa Mysore, and etc. So next is the bivolatile races. So there will be two generation per year. And also in first generation, they will be laying non-diaposing eggs. Whereas the next generation, the egg will be laid, which remain dormant till the next spring. And also these races will be able to tolerate environmental fluctuations. And some of the examples they have given here. So, that is the Central Sericulture Research and Training Institute. They develop races, and some of the example it is given here. You have to go through and you have to by heart all these races. So then some races were developed by RSR in Kalimpong, that is Regional Sericulture Research Station. Next, some races are also raced by the Karnataka State Sericulture Research and Development Institute, that is KSO1 and SP2. So next is the crossbreed between the multivolatile and the bivolatile. So in India, if you take, over 95% of the commercial silk being produced is from multivolatile female and bivolatile male parent. So they have given example. The main parents were like PM and NB4D2 and PM and NB18. So you have to remember all these races. And also these two races, they have some limitations, like they will be having a lower shell weight, high rendita, then low cocoon shell ratio, and also they are having poor fiber quality. So they crossbred other races also, like BL23 with NB4D2. So this is a hybrid that is meant for rain-fed areas in some places in Karnataka. So you just have to go through this, nothing to explain in all these. So you have to by heart very well. They may ask like example of multivolatile and bivolatile, they may give four races and they will ask you to choose one. So next is the multivolatile and multivolatile hybrid. There is only one hybrid, that is PM by C. Nichi Varuna. Next is bivolatile hybrid. So we know that hybrid is to improve any quality. So in silkworm, it is to better the cocoon weight, silk recovery percentage, raw silk percentage, filament length, and also neatness. So you need to again by heart all those races. So next is we are going to see about the cultivation of mulberry. So in India, the most important species of mulberry is Morus alba. Morus alba is the one that is cultivated mostly in India, in more area. Next is Morus indica, Morus bombensis, Morus sinensis, and Morus multicaulis. In this, Morus alba is very much important. And also they belong to family Moraceae. So question may be asked, that is the cultivation of mulberry is known as slash. So it is nothing but moriculture. So next, so the silkworm, they will not prefer any old leaves. They will prefer only fresh, soft, succulent, and smooth leaves. And also another main character is that they should have very low fiber content. And let it be any plant, the insect should first attract it to that particular plant. So in mulberry, the attracting factor is the essential oils present in them, that is citral, terpenyl acetate, linalool, hexanol, that will excite their olfactory sensilla, so that they can smell wherever they are and they get attracted to the plant. Next is the biting factor. So once they reach the plant, they should bite. For that, it should enhance the gustatory sensilla, and the flavonoids like isoquercetin and morin, this will help in the action in gustatory sensilla. Next is that they have to continue feeding till they are full. So for that, some cellular supplementary mineral factors like potassium, dibasic phosphate, and silica, as well as inositol, will be helpful. So next, we are going to see about the cultivation of mulberry plants. So the mulberry plants, it comes up well in any soil and also in any climate, and it is propagated by cutting. So only through cutting these are propagated. And first, the land is plowed well about 6 to 7 times in April, May season. And they are manured with cattle manure at the rate of 20 to 25 tons per hectare. They may ask the rate in exam. Next, what they will do is they will construct furrows that are opened a meter. That will be here. You can see the furrows. So that will be opened a meter apart either way, and at the junction, small pits they will scoop out. And in that small pit, they will be planting 2 or 3 cuttings. So each cutting should be of 20 to 22 centimeter long. So this is the cutting. It should be 20 to 22 centimeter long. And also the main thing is that they should be having 3 nodes. So when the plant, it grow too high, they are cut back, and this will help in the production of new flush of leaves. And also the plant can yield well for 12 years, after which they are pulled out and fresh plantings will taken up. So from the plants, each year 6 to 8 crops of leaves can be taken, and the average yield per hectare is 25 to 30 metric tons of green leaves. So here I have mentioned some of the varieties of mulberry that are being cultivated in India, that is Ananda, S30, V1, S13, 36, 54, then RFS 135 and 175. Please go through the races. So next is the pests and diseases of this mulberry plant. So the first one is the root knot disease, that is caused by Melanogyna incognita, and the main symptom is the gall on the root region. So next is Tukra disease. It is again caused by a pink mealybug, that is Macronellicoccus hirsutus. Next is thrips. There are many thrips that are seen in Mulberry, like bat thrips, Melanicornis, Megaluro thrips, Distalis, Frankiliella species, and Cryptothrips dorsalis. So next is Bihar Kari caterpillar. They will destroy the entire mulberry by defoliating the leaves, and it is another important pest. And next is mites. Actually, around 15 mites are there, but these three are the most important mites that are seen in mulberry in India, that is Asaria, then Tetranychus epitorius, and Tetranychus ludani. So these are the three mites that are seen in India, and they are highly destructive. So next we are going to see about the practice, how the silkworms are reared. So before rearing, we have to go for disinfection. Since the eggs and early larval stage of silkworms, they are very much prone to various diseases. And also it is very much necessary to disinfect the rearing house and also the rearing appliances with 2% formalin. So they may ask, what is the disinfectant that are used? So 2% formalin prior to the commencement of each rearing. So, and also for effective disinfection, rearing appliances should be kept inside the rearing house. Then doors and also windows should be closed airtight, and then it should be sprayed with 2% formalin, and also at the rate of 7 to 8 liters per 100 square meter. And also in order to protect it from going outside, all the doors and everything should be shut. So after 24 hours of disinfection, door should be opened and it should be aerated at least 24 hours before commencement of brushing. So brushing is nothing but the transfer of newly hatched larvae to the rearing bed. So if the house had infestation in the previous rearing, then it should be disinfected with double the concentration. That is like 4% you have to use. So next is, let's see what are all the equipments or appliances that are needed for the silkworm rearing. First one, it is the rearing stand. So these are made of wood or bamboo, and it will be like 2.5 meter high, 1.5 meter long, and also 1.5 meter wide, with about 10 shelves with a space of 20 centimeters between each shelf. And also the rearing trays will be arranged in the shelf. So in a whole shoot feeding method, what they will do is, they will the rearing stand, which should be 5 to 5.5 feet with 1 foot above the ground level, and with 2 feet, and with two width will be 2 feet. And also the distance between the rearing stand and wall should be maintained. Next is the ant well. That is, these are provided around the legs of the stand to stop the ants crawling onto the tray, because these ants are one of the predators that will feed on the the caterpillar of the silkworm. So these are made of concrete stone base, like 20 centimeter square and 7.5 centimeter height. So that are not needed for you. So next is the rearing trays. So they may ask the function of these particular equipments. So these are used to rear silkworms, and they are made of bamboo. Next is the rectangular wooden trays or boxes. So these are what is used for rearing early age. Early age larva is being used in this, and it is made of very light woods. 8 boxes will be required for 100 DFLS. DFLS means disease free laying. We will see in the next slides. So next is the paraffin paper. So it is a thick craft paper that is coated with paraffin. It is used for rearing early age. It is also used for rearing the early age worms on the bottom, and it's a cover of the rearing bed. It can also be used as a cover for the rearing bed, and also to prevent withering of the chopped leaves. So in the tray there will be spaces, so the leaves may get withered. So in order to avoid this, the paraffin paper can be used. So next is the foam rubber strip. So it is actually dipped in water and are used to keep all around our silkworm rearing bed during first 2 instar. It is nothing but just to maintain the humidity. So next is the chopsticks. A pair of chopsticks is being used to pick early age larvae and also for preparing the bed. Next is feather. So this is used for brushing the delicate newly hatched worms onto the rearing bed. Next is the chopping board. It is used for cutting the mulberry leaf because we are not going to feed the silkworm directly with the whole mulberry. We have to chop it, then only we have to feed it for the silkworm. So for that chopping board is needed. Chopping knife is also needed. Next is mat. It is used for collecting the leaves when chopping is done on floor in order to prevent the dust and also dirt on the floor that will get mixed with these leaves. Next is leaf chamber. These are maintained in rearing house for storing the harvested mulberry leaf that is ready for feeding the worms at set intervals. Next is the cleaning nets. These are made of cotton or nylon of different mesh sizes in order to suit the stage of the larvae. So these are actually used for cleaning the rearing birds, and at least 2 nets will be required for each rearing tree. Next is the mountage. This is the last one. That is, these are used as supports for the silkworm to spin. In order to spin the cocoon, these mountages are used. So next we are going to see about how the rearing is done. So first of all, as I said, transfer of new hatched larvae from egg onto rearing bed is known as brushing. So what we will do is we will first take a 4x3 inch tray. In that 50 DFLS. DFLS is nothing but the disease-free laying. So 100 disease-free laying, that is nothing but eggs, will be equal to 40,000 eggs. In a one sheet, there will be 40,000 eggs will be there. So this can be brushed and reared up to first mount. And then 25 DFLS up to second mount. Then the egg sheets are distributed in required number per tray before hatching. Fresh tender, as I said, they will feed only on the fresh tenders and succulent mulberry leaves. And also the leaves should have at least the moisture content up to 80 to 85%. So it will be collected and then it will be chopped and spread over the hatched larvae on the egg cart. So after 30 minutes, when all the worms have crawled on the leaves along with the worms will be transferred onto the paraffin paper on a rearing tray. So here you can see the rearing tray with the help of a soft feather. In the second picture, you can see the feather and it is arranged in the form of a thin bed. So clean, wet foam pads will be kept. It is just to maintain the humidity in the tray. Then they will pile up. So here you can see they have piled up the trays. So they will pile up trays one above the other in the form of a box to conserve leaf moisture for a longer period. So in the case of loose eggs, if it is not the sheet, if you are getting only loose eggs, then what you can do is 2 layers of cotton or nylon net like this. So you can see here. So this is the nylon net. In that it is spread over them. On noticing the hatching of eggs chopped leaves, they are spread over the net. So after an hour, the worms along with the top net are lifted and it is brushed in a chowky tray. So rearing of this young age silkworm. So rearing of young age silkworm up to second molt is what is known as chowky rearing, which usually lasts up to 10 days. And under optimum rearing condition, the worm may take up to three to three and a half days to settle. And for second molt, it will be taking like 2 to 2.5 days. So towards the end of final instar, what happens is the larvae will stop or reduce consuming leaf. They will release wet fecal matter. They will shrink in size and also the body becomes translucent. And they will start crawling in the bed with raised head. So such larvae will be collected and they will be mounted on bamboo or other types of mountages. So the temperature that should be maintained is 24 degrees Celsius with humidity of 60 to 65%, and also good aeration will be there, should be there. So this is what is ideal for the spinning of the silk. So the cocoons, they will be harvested on the 5th or 6th day after spinning. And also the stage of silkworm, when it's synthesizing silk, are 4th and 5th instar larvae. So only the 4th and 5th instar larvae, they can synthesize the silk. So it is also one of the important, they may ask which instar will be synthesizing the silk. So after that, the double cocoons and the flimsy cocoons will be discarded. So in next slide, we will see what are these cocoons. So once the cocoons are selected, the defective cocoons should be discarded. So what the types of defective cocoons are mentioned below. The first one, it is double cocoon. So a double cocoon, it is spun by two worms that is producing a filament. You can see there are two pupa inside a single cocoon, which does not unwind smoothly, and also the tangles, they will be tangling easily. As these cannot be reeled along with the normal cocoon, double cocoons are used for manufacture of a coarse, non-uniform and also stubby yarn. That is what is called as dupion. So that dupion word is also very important. Next is the double cocoon may be caused by crowded mounting conditions, high temperatures, high humidity, and also mutation of the silkworms. Next is the thin end cocoon. So thin end cocoon is nothing but one or both the end of the cocoons are very thin and risk bursting when processed. So the cause of this defect may be attributed to species characteristics or improper temperature and humidity during rearing and mounting. So next is the pierced cocoons. Pierced cocoons is nothing but this happens when the moth is emerged and it is being eaten by beetles, or it is being attacked by any parasite. And also these pierced cocoons are also unfit for reeling and can be used only for the hand spinning. Next is the malformed cocoons. That is, they are abnormally shaped cocoons and they can also be not used for reeling. This may be caused due to racial characteristics and reeling with mulberry leaves that are stained with agrochemicals. Next is the flimsy cocoons. So this is another defective cocoons. Here the shell is loosely spun in layers and has a very low silk content. These cocoons are easily overcooked. They may be overcooked and will produce waste. So next procedure. So now we collected the cocoon. So what happens is the cocoon is actually constructed of a single reelable thread of silk. So if we have to get that type of silk, the moths are allowed to emerge from the cocoons. The silk thread, if the moths are allowed to emerge from the cocoons, the silk thread will be cut during the process. Therefore, the pupae are killed 2 or 3 days before the emergence of the moth by exposing them to sun for about 2 or 3 days, or passing them through steam or a hot air oven, or by fumigating them with a chemical. So the process of killing of the moth inside the cocoon is what is called as stippling. So stippling is also a very important word they may ask in exam. So after that, what happens is the partial drying of cocoon will be done. About 75 to 85% drying is done. Then this stiffened cocoon will be dried. The loose outer floss is removed by brushing. And also they are then soaked in warm water to soften the gum that binds the silk thread. So in order to remove the gum, again they will be soaked in water. So the thread from 4 or 5 cocoons, they are put in a reeling machine and it is made into a single thread of sufficient thickness to form a raw silk. And about 50 to 62% of the silk of the cocoon is reelable, and here it forms the raw silk. So 50 to 62% will be raw silk and the rest will be waste silk. So these are the waste silk and this is the raw silk. So now it is killed. So next our work is for reeling. So how reeling is done is that it aims at extraction of the silk filament from the cocoons. So silk is produced by mainly using three reeling technologies, that is charkha, cottage basin and multi-end technology. So this is the multi-end silk reeling machine and this is the re-reeling machine. So why re-reeling is done is that it is to transfer the raw silk reeled on small reels to a large reel so that we will get uniform width, weight and also length of the skin. Then after reeling, it is followed by silk finishing, that is lacing and silk skiing and also bookmaking. So why this bookmaking is done is in order to protect the raw silk from damages by the moisture and also insect. So the cocoons that are required for further rearing are kept separately and also the moths are allowed to emerge from there. So a dry cocoon weighs about 1 gram and is about 2/3 weight of a green cocoon. The chrysalis is nothing but the pupa inside the cocoon. They will form 60% weight and the silk matter will form 40% of the weight. It has been estimated that about 60,000 cocoons yield a kilogram of raw silk. That is 60,000 cocoons is needed for a kilogram of raw silk. And also to produce this 1 kg, the tons of mulberry leaves are required. So you just imagine how much energy and it needs a lot of effort. So next is the silk. So silk, it is considered as the queen of textiles. Silk is a high value, but it is low volume product, accounting for only 0.2% of world's total textile production. And also this silk is a valuable natural protein fiber that is secreted from their salivary glands. And this silk, it is mainly composed of two primary protein, that is a fibrous protein known as fibroin. So it is also important, they may ask which protein is present in the silk. Next is the sticky protein that is known as sericin. So 70 to 80% will be fibroin and only 20 to 30% will be sericin. So the good quality grades will be A2A, 3A, 4A, 5A and 6A. So these are the grades that are given to the silk. And also 6A, which is a very rare and also it is very expensive. And the silk that is imported from China, it is 3A grade silk. So here you can see the different yarn, the silk, and this is the cocoon of different silkworms. So this is just a sheet that depicts the characters of different grades. So next is the silk mark. So a silk mark, it was launched on 17th of June 2004. The silk mark is promoted by Silk Mark Organization of India. It is a registered society under the Karnataka Society Act 1960. So this Silk Mark Organization of India is an initiative of the Central Silk Board and Ministry of Textiles and Government of India. So these are affixed only on pure silk product by the authorized users of Silk Mark. So the Silk Mark will be having a hologram and a unique number printed on it. And also it will help the consumer trace the product back to the authorized user. So the headquarters of this Silk Mark Organization of India is in Bangalore. And also the main objective of this Silk Mark is to protect the interest of the consumer, then to protect the interest of genuine traders and manufacturers of silk. Because you can see that there are many adulterated silk that are present in the market. And also the generic promotion of the natural silk. So in a Silk Mark, there will be a hologram and a unique number. So you should know when it came into effect, that is June 17, 2004. So next is the Silk Samagra. So the government of India, they has allotted 2,000 161.68 crore for about 3 years, that is 2017 to 2020, to a central sector scheme. It is a scheme started by the government of India for the development of sericulture in the country. It is implemented, this scheme is implemented by the Central Silk Board, and also it focuses on improving the quality and productivity of domestic silk. Therefore, it can be reduced the country's dependence on the imported silk. So under this scheme, the assistance is extended to sericulture stakeholders for beneficiary oriented components like raising of kisan nursery, plantation with improved mulberry varieties, irrigation, chowki rearing, etc. And also the scheme provide assistance for door-to-door service agent for disinfection and input supply, and also it supports for improved reeling units like automatic reeling units, multi-end reeling machines, as I mentioned before, and also improved twitching machines. Then also support for POSIAN facilities for quality silk and fabric production. So, and it comprises the following four components, that is research and development, then seed organizations, coordination and market development, then quality certification system. So this research and development units, they develop technology packages, and also they impart training on improved technology programs in order to the stakeholders, and also they transfer the technology. Whereas the seed production unit, they produce very basic and commercial seed of the improved silkworm breeds, which is developed by the research institute. Whereas the role of the quality certification team is to maintain and certify the quality standard that is set by the research and development units for silkworm seed, cocoon, raw silk, and also silk products. So next is the diseases of silkworm, that is mulberry silkworm. First one is the pebrine disease. So this pebrine disease, it is actually caused by microsporidian or protozoa, and the causal organism is Nosema bombesis. It is actually a chronic disease in silkworm. It is being transmitted to the offspring by transovarian transmission from the mother mouth. So the major symptom is that there will be pepper-like spot on the body of silkworm, and also the skin will be rubbery and dull in appearance. Though so these silkworm will get infected while they are feeding on the contaminated mulberry leaves, and also from surface contaminated eggs. So how they can be managed is that mother mouth examination can be done, or the disinfection of seed production unit, appliances, silkworm rearing houses, surroundings, and also the silkworm egg surface is also suggested. So next is the Grasseri. It is a viral disease. So these diseases are also very important. They may ask like which one is the viral disease, and they will give the options like pebrine, Grasseri, Fletcheri, and you have to choose one. So next one is the Grasseri. So it is also known as Halothonde, and it is caused by NPV virus. It is a type of baculovirus actually. And the major symptom of this Grasseri is that the skin will become brittle, that is hard, and also there will be white hemolymph seen on the body of the, so right side you can see the picture, white hemolymph, and also the skin will turn like yellow color. So the management will be, in case of high incidence of disease, you can spray 0.3% of slake lime solution in rearing house and appliances. So next is the Fletcheri, that is, it is a bacterial disease caused by the Bacillus bombiceptius. So the major symptoms will be like the infected larvae will turn black, and also since it is bacteria, there will be oozing out, and also the it may emit a foul smell, and the skin will become very flaccid. And also how it can be prevented is just like the disinfection I said for the pebrine disease. So next is the muscardine fungus. This may be white muscardine or green muscardine. So here, when it affects the silkworm larvae, the larvae turns into pink color and the body will become too hard. You can also see mummified larvae. Mummified means it will act like dead larvae. Then it can be managed by disinfecting with formalin 3% or bleaching powder 2% in 0.3% slaked lime solution. And also it is suggested for disinfection of rearing house, appliances, and even the surrounding, you can use this one. So next is the insect pest. One of the major insect pest is the oozy fly. So the scientific name is Exorista sorbillens. The term oozy appears to have originated after the name of a place in Japan, where the tachinid fly parasite of the silkworm was first reported. So it is a serious endoparasite of mulberry silkworm larvae. So it occurs during normally, I think, July to November, through and it will be prevalent throughout the year. So as I said, it is a endolarval parasitoid. So it will lay eggs inside the body of silkworm. So a single female can lay about 300 eggs, and the egg will hatch and the larvae enter into the body of the host and feed on the tissues for about 5 to 8 days. It then comes out of the body of the silkworm larvae, and about 12 to 20 hours after that, they will pupate in the loose soil. So they will enter the body of the silkworm through egg stage. Then they will come out as larva and they will pupate in the soil. So the symptom. The symptom will be like, you can see here, the black spots can be observed on the intersegmental surface of larvae, and also white creamy oval shaped egg. If you closely observe on the microscope, and also in your naked eye, it will be very minute. You can observe the eggs. So how it can be managed? So first of all, we can release the hyperparasitoid. Since it is a parasitoid, the hyperparasitoid is nothing but a parasitoid that is attacking another parasitoid. So this Nisolinx thymus, it is a hyperparasitoid. So it can be released in order to kill this particular oozy fly. This Nisolinx is a ectopuparial parasitoid. And next is you can just collect and destroy the larvae and puparia of oozy fly. Then prevention. Then you can prevent the entry to oozy fly by putting up nylon net to doors, windows, and also in ventilators. Then you can use UZ trap. It is a type of chemo trap that will effectively trap and kill the adult flies. And you can use oozycide. It is a ovicide that is available in liquid and powder form. So you just have to spray your dust on the body of silkworm. But you have to make sure that you should not spray during the period of molting. So another less important pest is dermestid beetle. The scientific name is Dermestis atter. So what we have to do is they are controlled by dusting bleaching powder, 30% chlorine it is, at 200 gram per square feet on the floor near the wall. Then the gunny bags or cotton bag, which are used for storing this cocoon, must be dipped in 0.028% delta methrin emulsion, and then they should be shade dried. This can also be sprayed on floors and walls of cocoon storage rooms. Then the pierced cocoons before storage can be dusted with malathion 5%. Dust at 1 kg dust per 10 kg cocoons. Then DDVP. This can be sprayed at the rate of 0.076% on stands and also rooms. So these are some of the Indian institutes. That is Central Silk Board. That headquarters is at Bangalore. That is Karnataka state. Then it is Central Sericulture Research and Training Institute at West Bengal. Then it is Central Tazar Research and Training Institute at Ranchi. Then Central Muga Eri Research and Training Institute, it is at Jorhat, Assam. So there is chance for asking these institutes in exams. So silk board, I have been mentioning many times about this silk central silk board. So this central silk board, it is a statutory body that is established in the year 1948 by an act of parliament. So as I said, it is controlled by the Ministry of Textiles and Government of India, and their headquarters is at Bangalore. So here I have listed out the objectives of for the Central Silk Board. First is they will promote the development of silk industry. Then they will undertake and also assist and also they encourage the scientific and also economic research. Then they will advise the central government on all matters regarding the development of silk industry. That includes even the import and export of raw silk. And they also helps in preparing and furnishing such other reports relating to the silk industry. So till now we saw the mulberry silkworm. So now we are going to see about the non-mulberry silkworm. So there are four types of non-mulberry silkworms, as I say. The first one, it is Tazar silkworm. The scientific name is Andrea millita. It belongs to family Saturninidae and order Lepidoptera. So this tazar is actually a copperish color, coarse silk, and it is mainly used for furnishing and interiors. It is less lustrous than the mulberry silkworm, but has its own feel and appeal. It is also very much used in nowadays in textiles. So this tazar silk is generated by the silkworm, as I said, Anthuria millita. They mainly thrive on food plants, Azan and Arjun. These are the two major host plants of this particular silkworm. So they may ask the host plant of this particular silkworm in the examinations. So the rearing are conducted in nature on the trees in the open. So unlike mulberry, they are not fully domesticated. And also in India, tazar silk is mainly produced in the state of Jharkhand, Chhattisgarh, Orissa, besides Maharashtra, West Bengal and Andhra Pradesh. And also the tazar culture is the mainstay for many a tribal community in India. So next is that at present, 0.56 million hectares of forest is covered with tazar silk production, while an estimated 11.16 million hectares are eligible for cultivating this tazar silkworm. And let's see the biology of this silkworm. So the eggs, you can see in the left side top. So the eggs are laid on tender leaves of the host trees, and a moth, it will lay up to 200 eggs. And the egg stage lasts for 8 to 10 days. The caterpillar will be stout green with red spiracles. So you can observe red spiracles on their body. And the larval period will be about 35 to 70 days. And the peculiarity of this tazar cocoon is that they will be having a large pedicel-like thing. That is, it is as large as a hen's egg. The egg will be large as hen's egg. It will be having a hard case hung from the terminal branches by a stiff attachment about 5 cm long. The pedicel will be about 5 cm long, and the pupal period will stay for 25 to 50 days. And also the moth, it do not mate in captivity. That is why this caterpillar cannot be domesticated. They can only be reared in the open area. So they may ask, which of the following is silkworms are completely, non-domesticated. So you can write this option of tazar silkworm. So as I said, the caterpillar cannot be domesticated, and also the silk is reliable. And in airy silkworm that I will take in the next slide, in airy silkworm, the silk is not reelable, but in tassar, it is reelable, and also the pupae have to be killed before the emergence of the moth in order to prevent cutting of the silk thread into pieces. So next is the oak tassar. It is Antheria broili. This is a native of China. So in China, this species is also known as Antheria perni, and they are exclusively feed on the oak trees, and they found in abundance in the sub-Himalayan belt of India, covering the states of Manipur, Himachal Pradesh, Uttar Pradesh, Assam, Meghalaya, and Jammu and Kashmir. As I said, China is the major producer of this particular silkworm. So next is the airy silkworm. So airy means it exclusively feed on the castor. That's why the larvae will be green in color. So this also belongs to the family Saturnidae, and they are also known as ND or RND. So airy is a multi-volatile silk that is spun from open ended cocoons, unlike other varieties of silk. And as I said, they exclusively feed on the castor leaf. And also, the airy cocoons are mouth open and can be spun. The silk is used indigenously for preparing of chaddas. So this is the shawls, chaddas by the tribals. In India, this culture is practiced mainly in the northeastern state and also Assam. And it is also found in Bihar, West Bengal, and Orissa. So another important thing is, we will move on to the biology. So airy silkworm, here the adult will be stout and dark, and the wings will be darkish brown in color. The moth will lay about 120 to 200 eggs in cluster, which will hatch in 7 to 10 days. The caterpillar has a green body, as I said, because their host plant is castor. So they will be green in color with a brown head, and the body will be having tubercles. You can see here, they are having tubercles all over the body. And also they will bear short hairs. The fully grown caterpillar will be about 8 centimeter long. And also it can pupate anywhere. So there is no need for chantriki, unlike the mulberry silkworm. The cocoon is also not compact, but it is loosely spun. The silk is white or will be brick red in color. You can see here, it will be white or will be brick red in color. And also it is not glossy as mulberry silk. And also it is not in one single strand. Therefore, it is not reelable. And also it has to be carded and spun like cotton. So next is the Muga silkworm. The scientific name is Antheria assamensis, family Saturnidae, and the order Lepidoptera. This Muga silkworm, it is a golden yellow colored one, and it is semi-domesticated and multi-volatile. And their main host are Somu and Swala plants. Even though their main plants are this, they feed on about 18 hosts. And the period of life cycle may prolong from nearly 1.5 months in summer to about 3 months in winter. The larvae on hatching will be yellowish in color, but as they grow, they turn to translucent green. And the cocoons will be light to deep brown, but white is not uncommon. It is also seen. So as I said, it will be golden yellow in color. And also another important point of Muga silk is that the golden yellow Muga silk of Assam has been granted geographical indication. So next is the Ahimsa silk. So what happens is, as the process of harvesting the silk from the cocoon, it kills the larvae. Sericulture has been criticized by animal welfare and also rights activists. So Mahatma Gandhi was very much critical of this silk production based on ahimsa philosophy, that not to hurt any living thing. This led to Gandhi's promotion of cotton spinning machines, an example of which can be seen at the Gandhi Institute. If you go in Gandhi Institute, even now you can see that. He also promoted ahimsa silk, wild silk that are made from the cocoons of wild and semi-wild silkworm. That is, he completely opposed the domesticated silk rearing. So this ahimsa silk concept is that it is a method of non-violent silk breeding and harvesting. The wild silk molds are bred rather than the domestic variety. It allows the completion of the metamorphosis of the silkworm to its moth state. That is, no need for killing the moth at it when it is present inside the cocoon. Whereas most silk harvesting requires the silkworms to be killed in their cocoon stage. And also here, no animals suffer or die for the silk to be produced, making it a favorable alternative to normal silk for those who do not believe in harming animals.